birth of a nation. Hebrew kingdom building. So I know you've heard this question asked before. Was Jesus black? And when you ask that question, most of the time there's immediate pushback by certain groups. The most popular lines that you hear are, "What difference does it make?" Or, "I don't care what color he was, as long as his blood was red." Or, "Jesus wasn't black or white, he was Middle Eastern." So as we see, there's great dispute over the color of the Messiah and the true Israelites of the Bible. Now over time, there's been alleged artifacts, supposed DNA, and artwork that people use to suggest that Christ looked rather European or Arab. But when we compare them to scripture, true history, and archaeology, they don't hold water at all. So before we get into what he actually looks like, let's answer the million-dollar question. What difference does it make? Let's say a billionaire went on vacation and got lost in a foreign country. And while he was lost, he and his kids got separated and his children were the heirs to his fortune. But the children have no photo ID, no driver's license, and no passport. Plus their father is nowhere to be found. How would you locate him or the children? You would have to make a composite sketch. And the info that you would need to know, for starters, would be like race, hair color, eye color, height, etc. All these things could give you a general idea from the genetic background of the parents, i.e. if the parents were black, so would the children be black. If the parents are white, so would the kids be white, etc. So the obvious reason why the race of Jesus is important is because in order for you to correctly identify the descendants of the true children of Israel, you must identify the race of the Messiah, because the Messiah was an Israelite from the tribe of Judah. And Christ warned that in the last days that there will be a people going around masquerading as the true children of Israel, but are really the agents of Satan. Revelation 2 verse 9. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them who say they are Jews and are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. So if we want to know what the Israelites look like, how about let's start with actual images of the Israelites not drawn by Europeans in the 1600s. Like these images of the tribe of Judah made by the Assyrians in 701 BC. Now when you compare the images of the tribe of Judah, the tribe Jesus was from by the way, to the images that the Europeans made in the 1600s, you see a drastic difference. In the Assyrian reliefs, Judah has nappy beards, cornrows, and dreadlocks, and traditional Negro features. But in the Renaissance paintings made by Europeans, they look like characters from the Game of Thrones. So which depiction is accurate? Let's see which image is supported in the scriptures. Black hair or blonde hair? Songs of Solomon 5 verse 11. His head is as the most fine gold, and his locks are bushy and black as the raven. Leviticus 13, 31 through 32. If the priest look on the plague of the skull, and behold, it be not in sight deeper than the skin, and that there is no black hair in it, and the priest shall shut him up, him that has the plague of skull 7 days. And in the seventh day, the priest should look on the plague, and behold, if the skull spread not, and there be no yellow hair in it, and the skull be not in sight deeper than the skin. So we see in the Levitical law, anyone who had blonde hair would be considered to be a leper, sick and unclean. But we also see that the Hebrews had jet black kinky hair, and according to Songs of Solomon, locks that were black as a raven, braided hair, or long hair straight and flowing. 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 through 5. Whose adorning let it not be that outward adorning, but the plaiting of the hair, and wearing of gold, or putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart, in which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which in the sight of God of great price. So Peter was writing to the women of Israel and told them not to let their outward appearance define them, but their inner woman. But it stated that they wore their hair in plaits. So let's look at that word in the text. Plaits, implote, a interweaving, braiding, a knot, an elaborate gathering of one's hair into knots. Now only African women wear these types of hairstyles to this day. And one of the most well known is the Bantu knots. But you also have cornrows, micro braids, and braids. Golden locks or dreadlocks. Number 6, verse 5. In all the days of the vow of separation, there should not a razor come upon his head until the days be fulfilled in which he separated himself unto the Lord. He shall be holy, and he shall let the locks of the hair of his head grow. Judges 16, verse 13. And Delilah said unto Samson, hereunto hast thou mocked me, and told me lies. Tell me wherewith thou mightest be bound. And he said unto her, if thou weavest the 7 locks of my head with the web. Again, Songs 5, verse 11. His head is as the most fine gold, and his locks are bushy and as black as the raven. As we see in these images of the tribe of Judah, men grew dreadlocks, and according to the book of Numbers, a man would grow dreadlocks if he separated himself unto a vow. It's called the vow of a Nazarite. And who was the most famous Nazarite? You guessed it, Jesus Christ of Nazareth. The black man is the only man on earth who hair locks without any treatment or intervention. No European or Arab hair locks by itself. Black skin or white skin? Leviticus 13, verse 4. And if the bright spot be white in the skin of his flesh, and in the sight be not deeper than the skin, and the hair thereof be not turned white, then the priest shall shut him up, him that hath the plague, 7 days. Then shall the priest look upon him, and behold, if the skull be spread in the skin, the priest shall not seek for yellow hair. He is unclean. But if the skull be in his sight a stay, and that there is black hair grown up therein, the skull is healed. He is clean, and the priest shall pronounce him clean. As we see in the book of Leviticus, any Israelite with white skin or white spot upon them will be considered to be leprous, unclean, and with a plague. Job 30:30, my skin is black upon me, and my bones are burned with heat. Songs of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 5. I am black, but calmly, O ye daughters of Jerusalem, as the tents of Kedar, as the curtains of Solomon. Song of Solomon, chapter 1, verse 6. Look not upon me because I am black, but because the sun has looked upon me. My mother's children were angry with me. They made me the keeper of the vineyards, but my own vineyard have I not kept. Again, Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 11. His head is as the most fine gold, and his locks are bushy and black as the raven. Lamentations chapter 5 verse 10. Our skin was black like an oven because of the terrible famine. Again, we see that white skin and yellow hair are associated with plague. But according to the Israelites' own words, there were black people with kinky hair. Seeing that we looked at the Assyrian reliefs already, let's look at some of the images from the time of the apostles. As we see, there were no white images of Christ and the disciples until the time of the Renaissance. This is why when Herod sent to kill Christ, Mary and Joseph took Christ to Egypt to hide him. How do you hide a white or Arab baby amongst black people? Of course, it's not possible. Just as you could not hide baby Moses in the house of Pharaoh after Pharaoh gave the commandment to kill every Hebrew male child, if Moses was white or Arab. The only way you can hide Moses or Christ is if they look identical to the Egyptians. So just in case you thought that the current people who live in Egypt are the original Egyptians, let's look at some images of the original Hamite Egyptians, or Kemet, who ruled over Egypt from the time of Moses to Christ. See, the Egyptians didn't call themselves Egyptian. That is a word that the Greeks used to describe them, Egyptos. But they called themselves Kemet, which means black. Let's see if the so-called Jewish people or the African American resemble the ancient Egyptians the most. Now you see why Paul was mistaken for an Egyptian in Acts chapter 21. Acts 21, verses 38 to 39. Art not thou that Egyptian, which before these days made us an uproar and led us out into the wilderness 4,000 men that were murderers? And Paul said, I am a man, which am a Jew of Tarsus, a city in Cilicia, a citizen of no mean city. And I beseech thee, suffer me to speak unto the people. This is also why, when the apostles began to spread out and do missionary work in places like Greece, the Greeks called them niggers or nigers. Acts 13, verse 1. Now there were in the church that was at Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, which was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, and Manine, which had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch and Saul. Why did the Greeks in Antioch call the tribe of Judah, or what we call today Jews, niggers or nigers? Well, let's ask a Roman who was alive during that time. The following quote is from the first century Roman historian Tacitus from his book, The Histories, Book 5, 110 CE. Many, again, say that they, the Jews, were a race of Ethiopian origin, who in the time of King Cephas were driven by fear and hatred of their neighbors to seek a new dwelling place. Now during the time of Tacitus, the Greeks and the Romans called any black group of people who were not Egyptians, Ethiops, which is where we get the term Ethiopian, which originally was Ethiopian, meaning burnt face or black face. So according to Tacitus, the Romans who held the Hebrews in captivity thought that they were Ethiopians, not Europeans or Arabs. Even the name of Abram's homeland, Ur of the Chaldees, which is modern-day Iraq, meant burnt like an oven or black as an oven. The founders of the Mesopotamian civilizations were black Sumerians or Chaldeans. Mesopotamia was the biblical land of Shinar, which is Sumer and Babylon. The Sumerians left no doubt to how they viewed themselves racially. The Sumerians called themselves Sagiga, meaning the black-headed people. The Sumerians would shave their heads in the blazing Iraqi heat, which at that time the average temperature was 120 degrees, hence the nickname. Finally, there's the image that we all know of Christ, with the long flowing red blonde hair, or brown hair and blue eyes and brown eyes. What most don't understand is that the image of that Christ is the actual image of a person. His name is Caesarea Borgia. Caesarea Borgia, or Borgia, was Leonardo da Vinci's gay lover who had an incestuous relationship with his sister and was involved in several murders. This man is the actual image of who we call Christ, that's been shipped around the entire world as the image that people know as the Son of God. So now, since you have all the information, which image is correct? The black image of Christ and the Israelites, or the European and Arab images of Christ and the Israelites?